Hello, everyone. Welcome to this morning's panel. We're very happy that you're here. We're excited to have a conversation today. This panel called Design Fuels Recovery is really a discussion between some very interesting minds, exploring the question, as New York City begins to reemerge, what is the role of design, particularly through furniture design, as we look towards the future? As we're starting to reemerge from this pandemic, how do we fully incorporate sustainability with health and equity and all that we've learned in the last year? So this panel is part of NYC by Design's Design Days, which is 6 days of celebrating creativity in New York City. This effort by NYC by Design has really taken hold in the last couple of years, and we're thrilled to be part of it. This particular session is co-sponsored by mebl, Transforming Furniture, with Parsons Healthy Materials Lab. Our hope is to spark ideas about new sustainable paths for furniture design and production. So thank you all for joining us from all these places, from Cape Town, South Africa, from Mumbai, and maybe even from New York City. So maybe we'll get started, and I'll give you a brief introduction of the panelists. I'm Jonsara Ruth. I'm the co-founder and design director at Parsons Healthy Materials Lab in New York City. I'm also associate professor of interior design at Parsons. And I'm a designer of my own, in my own right. And I'm principal at Salty Labs, which is a design studio that I founded about 8 years ago, where I spent the first 12 years of my professional life, though, really immersed in the furniture design field. I was a designer for mass production furniture, where we produce furniture all over the world, and then eventually in the United States and even in New York City. So that's a little bit about me. I think there's going to be more extensive bios put in the chat here. But I'll be the moderator for today's panel. And I'm thrilled to introduce the other folks who are joining us here today. So you'll see on your screen, Mona Chun, who's my collaborator and producing this event today. Mona is the Chief Operating and Sustainability Officer for mebl Transforming Furniture in Brooklyn, New York. In this role, she brings together experienced leadership in human rights and in sustainability with and advocacy with a love for design. In fact, we learned that before textile recycling was in vogue, Mona commissioned her Chinese wedding dress to be made from a discarded offcut of textiles of Versace fabric. So fabulous. I'd love to see a photograph, Mona. Maybe you'll share it someday. We also have Sabrina Murayo Nunez. Sabrina is a Latinx woman who is both a visual artist and a furniture maker and founder of Lunfarda Studio. She's originally from Argentina. She's today in New York City, where she moved in 2018 to continue her work making furniture and sculpture from reused objects with a deep respect for history, for new technologies, and for nature and our relationship to nature. A random fact about Sabrina is that she loves to collect cans that she finds on the street, which have been crushed by rushing traffic. Fabulous. I want to see an image of all these things. It's super interesting. And our third speaker is Tommy Safian. Tommy is a co-founder and driving force behind the innovative nonprofit ReFoundry, which is an organization that trains formerly incarcerated men and women to repurpose discarded materials into home furnishings. ReFoundry also mentors participants in their own businesses or career track job. Super interesting organization. Tommy also lives in Brooklyn, New York, and he has a wanderlust, we learned. He doesn't mind getting lost. He prefers open fields to pathways. He prefers bushwhacking his own way rather than following a trail. And to travel without an itinerary. I'm right there with you, Tommy. I love that. Anyway, I'm super excited to talk to these folks today. and I'm glad that you're here. Just a little bit of housekeeping. You'll see at the bottom of the screen, there's a few ways to chat. There's a chat function, and then there's also a Q&A function. Please, if you have questions during this presentation, please put your questions in the Q&A. And so at the end of the panel discussion, around, I don't know, maybe in about 40 minutes or so, we'll go through the audience questions and open up a conversation with you. But please put your questions specifically for the panelists in that Q&A function. So maybe we should begin to dig in. So our overarching goal today is to highlight and dig into these new ways of thinking about sustainability in furniture design and in production, which really specifically address these questions that are on the screen here, which is really about how do health, equity, and materials come together to define sustainability? And how can we approach materials and human resources differently than we have in the past? And why is design particularly important now as we reemerge from this long year and reimagine, or we imagine new for a new future where we can recover? So those are the kind of overarching questions that we're hoping to dig into today. And just to give you a little bit of background and to bring some context to the conversation, we've pulled together some statistics. Maybe just one slide earlier. Yes, thanks. So here's a crazy statistic. New York City, it turns out, discards 950 tons of furniture per day. That's close to 350,000 tons of furniture and furnishings each year. And just so that you can get more of a visual of to understand what that means, that would equal throwing away about 1,500 statues of liberty each year, which is a crazy amount of waste. Another statistic is in just 58 years, so just under 60 years, the annual waste of furniture and furnishings in the United States grew from roughly 2 million tons to roughly 12 million tons per year. And that, you know, that really indicates a change in behavior, a change in human behavior, that we're throwing away so much furniture, and a change in behavior in terms of how we're producing and how we think about disposability. So again, an image to just think about that. This waste, throwing away, you know, furnishings and furniture, would be equivalent to discarding approximately 823 Brooklyn Bridges worth of material waste in 2018, as opposed to just 146 in 1960. So we're throwing away so much more now than we ever have in history. So what does that mean about furniture production and furniture consumption? That's what we're digging into. Another startling statistic is that there's approximately 47 kilos of greenhouse gas emissions emitted into the atmosphere just in the production of one sofa. That's one sofa. So again, to give you a visual, that's the equivalent of about 5.5 gallons of gasoline each time a sofa is produced that goes into the environment. And, you know, much of these emissions come from the production of materials. So that go into making a sofa. So for instance, the production of foams or fillings or synthetic textiles produces these greenhouse gas emissions just in themselves. Here's another one. And the next slide, indoor air, what we breathe each day while we're sitting indoors can be 2 to 5 times more polluted than outdoor air. So you see these fumes coming from the sofa. A major emitter is the furniture itself. And off-gassing comes from formaldehyde used in composite wood products, the VOCs or volatile organic compounds from the finishes used in furniture, and also from stain repellents and flame retardants used in textiles and foams. All of this comes into the atmosphere of our indoor environment that, you know, we might keep it very clean but we are not in control of the way that the furniture is produced. As a consumer, we are not. We on this panel do have a little bit more control about this. So the question is, what happens with that indoor air? It turns out that these toxic substances that can be found in our indoor environments can contribute to chronic conditions like asthma, cancer, infertility, obesity, even diabetes, are linked to these same chemicals that are found in our furniture, in our sofas. And these health risks are particularly high for children or for pregnant women and those living in poverty. So if I speak from my role at the Parsons Healthy Materials Lab, we think of people in relation to materials. Next slide, please. We track the entire life cycle of a material to understand its impacts. On the next slide, we have a diagram of the life cycle. So we think about materials from raw extraction to construction and installation, to its use and its maintenance. So its use in use through to its the end of its life, through to the recycling stage or the disposal stage, or through its carbon impact throughout. And we're always bringing a particular focus to human exposure and environmental impacts at every stage of this life cycle. Our design decisions impact all stages of that production. So we decide what goes into a piece of furniture. We decide how it's made. And then ultimately that affects the people who use it. And it affects the entire ecosystem and the biodiversity of our planet. At Parsons Healthy Materials Lab and at the Healthy Materials Library, we find this framework for evaluating material health is really useful to think about like how we choose a particular material, to understand the impact of materials through the lens of, say, waste and circularity. By circularity, we mean, could it be used again in some form? By its impact in water, or the impact of carbon emissions, human health, or social equity. But it's not only the materials that impact health. Next slide, please. The inequities in social conditions can contribute to health disparities, or as we learned this year, pre-existing conditions, which make people even more vulnerable to toxics in their environments. So this is looking through the lens of the CDC, Center for Disease Control, social determinants of health. Gives insight into the experiential factors of people's lives that also play into their well-being, that gives them a predisposition towards perhaps being vulnerable to toxics in our environment. Next slide. So for me personally, as a designer and as a consumer, but also at the Healthy Materials Lab, it's this intersection between people, their experience, and materials that drives our research. Just a little introduction about our lab. At Parsons, we established the Healthy Materials Lab in 2015 to help designers and architects, faculty, and students rethink how they make things. So our focus in particular is to build the capacity of the affordable housing sector to achieve the widespread use of healthier building materials, to reduce that toxic chemical exposure in the US, and ultimately to advance healthier lives for the most vulnerable communities so that everybody can thrive. Our lab is made up of full-time design researchers, communications experts, and research assistants, many of whom are students or recently graduated. We collaborate as a basis for the way that we work, and we represent a range of disciplines, as do our advisors. And our goal is really to make our research a resource for others so that our website houses informative resources about healthier materials. Next slide, please. We created a series of courses and a certificate program called Healthier Materials and Sustainable Buildings, which you're welcome to register for. Registration's open until June 7th. which brings together many of the leading voices on material health from across this country and internationally to speak about material health. We grow materials collections to give examples of some of the healthiest building materials that are currently being produced, and we create guides explaining how to incorporate healthier material strategies into design. So if you go to healthymaterials.org, I hope you'll find some useful information. So that's a little bit about the context for this conversation, a little bit about the Healthy Materials Lab at Parsons and our particular point of view. But now I'm really excited to hear from our panelists. So next slide, please. Let's dig into some fascinating new ways of thinking about sustainability and furniture, incorporating these ideas of health and equity into design and sustainability. So Mona Chun, I'm gonna hand it over to you. Could you tell us a little bit about what you do at mebl and how you use the lens of sustainability in your work?
Sure. Thank you, Jansara, and thanks to Tommy and Sabrina for joining us. I'm really excited to be in conversation with all of you. And before we move on, you asked us, Jansara, to share a fun fact about ourselves. Can you share one about you?
A fun fact about me. Well, you know what? During this pandemic, I've had the privilege of living closer to nature than I usually do in Brooklyn. And the spring brings out all of these plants. And I'm actually living close to my family. And my mom has showed me how to forage in the forest. I've been spending a lot of time in the forest foraging for ramps and for mushrooms and for fiddlehead ferns and then bringing them home and eating them. So that's a fun fact, a recent fun fact.
That's fantastic. It sounds delicious too. So let me tell you a little bit about mebl. Mebl was started a few years ago with a focus on championing furniture made from reclaimed wood, metal, and plastic. We wanted to expand perceptions of what reclaimed could mean, which is high quality, long-lasting, beautiful, and interesting furniture. And as you could see in the slides, we seek to highlight that rather than just rustic barn board tables, this furniture is crafted and designed, and it could be transforming an old dismantled New York City water tower, as you see on the left, into a beautiful chair, or busted skateboards into a gorgeous stool, or old plastic toys that can become a colorful table, or discarded radiator even into a chair. So this is our foundation, where we can present just one solution, reclamation, among many for a more sustainable future through furniture. But we realized that wasn't enough. And we wanted to have a broader impact on what our people and our planet needed to be more sustainable. And for that reason, we're developing a campaign to increase knowledge around a more sustainable and circular approach to our furniture. So what does that mean, circular? Jansara mentioned it before. It's about shifting from our current linear and harmful approach of take, make, waste, which is what you see on the left. This is, we take resources, we make products, and then we throw them out when we're done with them. And that depletes our Earth's resources and overwhelms our landfills. As you heard from Jansara, we throw out over 12 million tons of furniture each year in the US alone. So instead, we're looking at how we move to a more circular approach that designs out waste, where we design for longevity rather than disposability. It's an approach that uses waste as a resource and creates systems and demand for things like services like renting or refurbishing, reselling, and otherwise keeping existing products and materials in the loop, which is the loop you see on the right. And so as we're promoting this systems change, as we'll talk about in this conversation, we want to ensure that people and planet are both part of the equation. because a truly sustainable future will need to integrate environmental justice and equity as well. So we want that to be part of the loop. So that's what mebl does.
That's great. Thank you, Mona. It's great to just hear the background. Just in particular, you know, you have this amazing background in human rights leadership. And it's so interesting to read about what you used to do and what you're doing now. How did you get involved in this journey into furniture and sustainability?
Yeah, well, I guess it's always been the idea of sustainability and all the waste in our lives has always been in my life. And I think that goes back to my dad and my childhood. And as a kid, you know, if we wanted to buy anything, my dad would always remind us that growing up in China, he didn't have his first pair of shoes until he was 8 years old. And if we were about to throw away food, he would tell us this awful story about how he saw his best friend at the age of 7 get shot because he was trying to steal a potato from a farm to eat. And so we grew up in a zero waste household. It was just called something different back then. In my house, it might have been called something like, do you really need to buy that? Or you can get way more uses out of that. You don't need to throw that out now. And so while I still like to buy shoes, it's just a good reminder to consider necessity and what will happen to that pair of shoes when I'm done with them. So I've always been thinking about waste, and I never really thought about furniture. You know, I've spent decades following like the sustainable food movement, and I never gave furniture a thought. So when Michael asked me to join the team, I was really excited. And diving in, I noticed how much this has been part of my life all along. I just never thought of it in this specific area. And with the human rights part, you know, it's the lens through which I see everything, and which is why I'm really excited about thinking about social equity and how humans are part of the equation, not just in the problem and not just in the solution, but in developing new systems that really are inclusive and equitable and just for everyone. And that includes in every way we interact with the world and our products.
Fascinating. What an amazing story. Yeah, it's amazing to hear what fuels us as we try to fuel the future. Thank you so much. So hopefully we'll be able to talk about that a little bit more. Sabrina, it's great to see you. Great to have you here. Could you tell us a little bit about what you do and how you use the lens of sustainability in your work at Lunfarda Studio?
Sure. Hi, everyone. Thanks to be here. I'm very happy to be part of this talk. Well, I'm a visual artist and a furniture maker. And I recently found Lunfarda Studio, which is a small project that I'm running right now. So I would like to share with you with some slides and some images to illustrate a little bit what is my activity. So I make my furniture, and I would like to share three aspects about my work that I think maybe define my practice. One is about to reuse materials and objects. I must say that maybe I reuse materials through objects, which is not the same. I like to keep the emotional links that we have with some objects, and I use that information to create some pieces. The second thing that I would like to highlight about the pieces is, and maybe came from the first one, is that there are all unique pieces, because in that combination that I do with material objects and the specific furniture that I choose to do the interventions, because that's the thing that I used to do. I used to choose some furniture, some wood furniture mostly, and then I do the intervention with different objects and materials. And that combination usually tells a story that is difficult to repeat exactly the same. And this is related too with my background as an artist. I'm not an industrial designer. So the way in which I develop the object is very different. And the last one that I want to share is about the craft, about the hand trace that you can see in all the products. And that it has to do with the, I mean, I love the decorative arts and all the story of furniture making before the Industrial Revolution, which is something that I really admire, because something that crosses all these characteristics that I am describing right now is about the humanity that for me is important that objects have, right? So I used to use all craft techniques like inlay, for example. You can see here that I put some objects like a key from typewriting, or so I put it in a way that maybe in another time it would be like a piece of wood or, you know, another kind of materials. I used to reuse another pieces of wood of different objects and I put it together. I used to disassemble objects and put it together. But I think that the most relevant thing about my way to think about sustainability is about to keep something similar to the thing that Mona was saying, right? To rethink about the objects that we already have in the world and how we can find another ways to keep that material going, right? So in this case, for example, I used an old book, and that is a polyurethane foam that I took from a waste that I found on the street, and I put it all together. And then I use leftovers of leather and all kind of stuff that I sometimes found, and sometimes people brings to me. That's the thing I do. And there is always about something about the stories that I create that it sometimes are more fun and sometimes I'm more ironical about the use of the objects. That's me and that's my project. Now I'm jumping in even further with the idea to create a team for work. And of course I was thinking in create a team of women and Latin American women. It'll be a great team for me. So that's why I'm thinking right now, and this is my work.
Thank you, Sabrina. Beautiful work. Thank you for that introduction. It's so interesting the way that you talk about your work as being from the point of view of a visual artist, and that you are also, you know, but you're making furniture. And I wonder, you know, how did you get involved in the furniture part of this? How did you go from making sculpture to making furniture?
Well, the thing is, I study the story of craft, decorative arts, and then I discover all the process of the craft work. And I was very surprised and very fascinated about the way in which furniture was created, like the ebonistry work, you know, all the work that it has to do with the craft, with the hands. And that got me like directly into the furniture. And I started to do some hybrid products. I still do hybrid stuff, but at that point, I just started to think about everything again, because my bag is in art, in contemporary art. So there is something about craft and about the link that you have with the objects, about the handmade work, and right, that it was very different. So when I jumped in all that historic background, I was very, very interested in all that stuff.
It's fascinating. You can see the love of craft in the work that you do.
Yeah, I mean, I think, again, it's about to be a human making a trace in an object, you know? I think that it's something, that is a powerful tool, right? Because for me, it's a way to link the humanity with the environment, you know? I mean, all the change that it comes from the tree to the furniture made with wood, all that chain, if you can keep the eye into the way, into the process that you have to do to get there, it's a way to have this link with the environment. And I think that it's a powerful tool that I'm researching right now. You know?
So interesting. Thank you. Thank you for sharing. Hopefully we'll dig into that a little bit more, but first we'll hear from Tommy. Tommy, could you tell us a little bit about Refoundry and how you founded it and how you think about sustainability, equity, and health in furniture?
Well, thank you. And also I want to thank New York City by Design, mebl, and Healthy Materials Labs, and everyone who's joined us today for this important conversation. Jansara, as you explained earlier, Refoundry is a new organization in criminal justice with a unique approach. We train formerly incarcerated people to repurpose discarded materials into home furnishings, and then mentor participants into business owners and professionals that become leaders and job creators in our communities. And within the context of today's conversation, I'm going to share a little bit about Refoundry's strategic model through the lens of sustainability. And Refoundry looks at sustainability, the model looks at sustainability in several ways that are all interconnected and converge at the confluence of criminal, economic, racial, and social justice, all of which include components of health, housing, and environment. So we're looking at re-engineering systems that produce waste, reclaiming value for things we've discarded, developing self-sustaining people and communities that feed on their own growth, and looking at scaling, the idea of scaling through an organic process driven by people and communities rather than intentional structured scaling that's often funded by external stakeholders, which don't always are not always truly authentic or work well. And when I think about what do we mean by sustainability, sustainability is not just what we preserve, but it's also what we collect and covet. Words, phrases, icons, things, all of which drive our perceptions, behaviors, and policies as individuals, as communities, and as a society. And Refoundry addresses sustainability within this framework, preserving, using, and taking our common resources and approaching that with purpose. We're essentially trying to tell a new story, performed and spoken authentically by the people we serve and those that they engage with. So if it's about to bring up the first slide, thank you. So here, this is Gene Manigo. He's one of our graduates. And this is a quote from him: as I work with materials other people have thrown away, I feel like I'm reclaiming myself. When others see I've made something of beauty and value and they buy it, I feel like they're seeing beauty and value in me too. And so you see that transformation both of materials and of the individual. And so Refoundry is looking at design, furniture is a central component of our program, looking at design as a visual three-dimensional language that goes far beyond function, format, and style. And as Sabrina mentioned, that those materials can have emotional resonance and connection to the pieces. So if you can go to the second slide, please. So this is Gene and a table he made of salvaged pieces of wood, mostly from dumpsters, that he built and designed himself into a tabletop, and used those materials in different ways. Sometimes he cross-cut the wood. Sometimes he, inlaid some of it. And that piece for him, he said that the design was as it moved your eye, the material in your eye moves inwards to the center. And he says that the outside is all the decisions that he has to consider. And as it moves inward, it helps him focus on making the right decisions. So the piece has design and function, but it also has meaning. And when he goes out and sells that piece, he tells that story, both about himself and about the piece. And that story is then carried on through him, through the piece, to the consumer, who then brings it into their home. And then they share that story with themselves, with their family, with their community, and that's what helps change a lot of perception. So the people we serve, they're using their own creativity, industry, and purpose to transform the stories and language often imposed on them into stories that they're the authors of, that demonstrate their value to themselves and to others, and of the materials they're using as well. If you could go to the next slide, please. So this is another Refoundry graduate, James, who says, used to go around looking for places I could rob. Now I go around looking for things people have thrown out that I can turn into a treasure. And so you see that kind of transformation, both of materials, of individuals, of value. And if you could go to the next slide. And so this is an example of a piece. That's a laundry dryer drum that rusted old, was discarded, that participant found, and the material on top is remnant yardage. And so they made a little ottoman and seat out of that. And this conversion of discarded resources, of materials, peoples, communities, into things and systems that all of us see shared value in. That's the approach of Refoundry. And I'll leave it at that because I don't want to go on too long.
Fascinating project and fascinating stories that you're telling through of James and Gene. So Tommy, it's such a unique and interesting organization that you've started and that you're running. How did you get involved in this journey from the beginning?
Well, I didn't have criminal justice or social justice on my radar at all. I started in the furniture business out of necessity. I wasn't making enough money when I was much younger to pay my bills and my student loans. And so I started picking up furniture out of the garbage and fixing it up and selling it on the street. And within a couple of years, then stores started buying it. In a couple of years, I had a factory and up to 30 employees. And I didn't have any training in that. It was just relying on craft and purpose, creativity, purpose, and industry, which I think all human beings have. It's how we got from banging a stick on the ground to where we are today in a relatively short amount of time. And So I was in the furniture business for a long time, and I was doing some small, about 6 or 7 years ago, I was doing some small business consulting, and a reentry organization, which I didn't know what that was at the time. It's an organization that helps people transitioning from back from incarceration, wanted to start a social enterprise in furniture and called me in, and I called in the other co-founder of Refoundry, who was a furniture colleague. And we knew, like most people, that our criminal justice system was dysfunctional, but really had no idea, particularly on the post-incarceration side, and the waste of human talent and financial resources and a whole assortment of other things. And just, you know, not always, you know, I was really driven by disgust, most of all. But we just felt that there was better solutions. And we thought that our experience could provide an example of one. So that's why we started Refoundry.
Really inspiring, really super interesting story. And, you know, I think we should return to this, these ideas of the way you define sustainability. I think somebody just mentioned that in the chat, which is, you know, that this idea of craft, creativity, purpose, industry, that these are aspects of humanity. These are aspects that everyone holds. And I think, you know, I think everybody here is tying into that. I think Sabrina, you spoke to that too. Whereas, you know, you're working really from an object that is, you know, crafted. And then as you pull it apart, you understand the craft and honor that craft and make it into something new. Where Tommy, you're saying that craft gives a person value, you know, and there's that human piece of that. It's really interesting. You know, I think this, and this idea of equity, social equity, and, you know, elevating the thoughts and the value of people, you know, or reorienting somebody from saying, I want to go rob, to saying, actually, I'm going to go take trash and make it into something new. It's a similar, you're tapping into an aspect of humanity. It's so interesting. I guess we're going to transition now, I think, into a larger conversation between all three of you. But, you know, Mona, you've been listening to Sabrina and to Tommy speaking, and you spoke a little bit about human rights issues. And I wonder how this reflects to you, this idea of humanity and equity in relation to sustainability and furniture and design. And here we are at New York City, NYC by Design. And how does this all tie back for you?
Yeah. I mean, I think I love hearing Sabrina's approach and Tommy's approach. And I think one way that we define sustainability is how we take care of and sustain human needs today without compromising the ability of future generations to do the same. And so when we talk about sustainability, often the emphasis is on environmental factors, and that's where we hear most about sustainability. But a full grasp of sustainability has to encompass these three interdependent and overlapping aspects. There's the environmental, which is things like carbon emissions and energy efficiency, which we hear a lot about. But there's the economic, the systems by which goods and services are produced and sold and purchased. But it's also the social, and that includes the health that you were talking about, Jonsara, and equity and welfare of all human beings. And we really have to attend to all three of these pillars in order to have a truly sustainable future. And I think as I talked about before with my background in human rights and how I see everything through the human and social lens, I think when I think of sustainability, or even for the work that we're doing in the furniture sector, I'm always thinking about things like fair wages and safe labor practices, or workforce training and development, diversity, equity, and inclusion, accessibility and affordability, community development and engagement, and how we include the voices and perspectives of local or affected populations, like who has the proximity, who lives in proximity to the factories and are dealing with the toxicity and pollution most. We have a right to healthy communities, and it's important for us to think about how marginalized communities are known to be disproportionately affected by climate change. So it is really important to tie all of these things together.
Yeah, you touched on so many aspects, and it's true. I think this idea of sustainability, or the definition of sustainability, feels to me like it's growing, right? What do we mean by sustainability? Feels like it's getting bigger. Tommy, you had a few words that you contributed to the definition of sustainability. I wonder if, do you want to talk about that more, and maybe you could bring in your idea about how do you scale this? Because, you know, what you're doing in New York is pretty incredible, and you're giving these people, you know, you're acting on these ideas of these human equity, bringing human equity into that idea of sustainability that Mona's describing. But how do you scale this idea? How do we all make bigger impact?
That's a really good question. I would say all the ideas that we're talking about and sharing here today, it's important how they engage with the marketplace, both the marketplace of ideas and the marketplace of consumers. And Sabrina's pieces, you see right away how they can engage with the marketplace of consumers. I mean, they're just stunning. And the sustainability is the piece. That's the piece speaks of sustainability in its beauty. And I think that's one way to scale, is through that consumer relationship. The best way to, or a very efficient way to get people to change their practices and perceptions and behavior, is through what they do every day, shop for what they need. And providing people with those options that meet also their values outside of the function, outside of the immediate impact or use of that piece, that really speaks to their greater values. And so that they can feel that they're participating in sustainability, in criminal justice, in environmental responsibility, by doing what, again, what they do every day, shop for what they need. So I think that commerce, as important as advocacy is, I come from the private sector, and I do feel that business and commerce is the fastest driver of change in our society. Leveraging that with purpose can be very, very effective way of scaling. Refoundry could scale. We could have 100 refoundries. It's not going to make, a significant difference, except for the people who we serve and their, maybe some of parts of their communities. So we're really trying to, in our model, we're not trying to make something that has any IP in it at all. It's something that others can look at and adopt and adapt to what they're doing. But again, in a conscious and purposeful way. And of course, are the people who graduate from our program go out, and they're the best ambassadors for change as well.
Yeah, and I imagine that's happening, that kind of network of understanding how to make value, how to create value, and how that then comes back and makes someone themselves feel valuable. I imagine that's spreading.
If I could just tell very briefly, so Jean Manigo, who I showed the picture of, he was 30 years in prison, and he went back. He's now going back to his home community and engaged his former gang, the former members of his gang, and converting that gang now into a community-based organization. So that's a way that he's taking what he got out of Refoundry and bringing it out into the world and having wider impact.
Mm-hmm. Amazing, amazing.
Well, I think
there's just a question, just to say IP, Tommy referenced IP as intellectual property.
Right.
So no ownership of intellectual property. Sorry, Sabrina, go ahead.
No, I just wanted to highlight this thing that Tommy said about the ways in which we consume. That is another strong key, right? Because how the way in which we produce, it has to be with the market too. So what's the way to get the products in the market, and what's the way for the people, for the consumers to get that product or to choose that product? I remember when I arrived, I've been here for 3 years. So, and I came from Latin America, and we have, maybe because we have a lot of poverty in our country, we have a large culture of reusing, right? We fix everything. And I remember that I was very surprised when I arrived, because I saw a lot of stuff in the street that it could be reused, you know? And then when the time I realized that it's cheaper, for example, to just throw away the furniture and buy new stuff than just keep that stuff with you. And I think if that stuff is the same as a lot of stuff and it's very cheap, and you know that it's not gonna be last, and you know, you just leave it there. So if you create some value about the objects that you have, and that objects are affordable too, you can make it start maybe a change, you know, in the way in which people consume the furniture. I don't know, it's just a thought.
No, I think it's a really good thought. And I think these questions of scale, consumer behavior, creating objects of value, reusing, making them, there's this tying together, I think, that's really important here. And, you know, it's something that I've spent a lot of time thinking about as well, is, you know, at least in this country, change happens a lot through commerce and business. It happens through this desire of people to want something, you know. Like you said, Tommy, like I'm going out to shop for something and I'm going to find that thing. And that's what drives the economy. I remember that, you know, remember that book, Natural Capitalism by Paul Hawken. I think he wrote it like 15 years ago or something. But it's that idea, you know, that just drives change in our culture. But, and then we think about the culture like Sabrina's speaking of, where there is already a culture of reuse. There is, out of necessity, there's a culture of reuse. And how does that change culture? And so I think that that's a really interesting idea. The question is, like, how do you create value? And I think so that you know, somebody took that washing machine drum and off the street and it was rusty, and they made it into something that's usable and desirable. Or Sabrina, in your work, you're making these beautiful pieces of furniture that are sculptural and intriguing out of something that might have been wasted. The question is, like, then how do we create value that's also accessible? Like, what about this accessibility piece that you're speaking of?
Well, I do think that's meeting the consumer where they are, not trying necessarily to, pressure or force through other ways the consumer to do something they're not comfortable with, but to meet consumers where they are, but then provide them with what they need, with what they feel they need, but that has added value to it, that speaks to their values outside of their particular need for an object or something. I just also, if I can add, so I want to build a little bit on what Sabrina said, is, you know, there are objects, they're not just objects that are around here. They're also other types of resources that are available that we don't really use. And so, for example, Refoundry has a 10-point life skills curriculum. But instead of us creating that curriculum from scratch, we go out into the marketplace and find experts in those fields to come in and teach them. And they do that because they want to, because it provides them with value. So for example, Capital One provides financial literacy. Google provides internet and computer literacy. The Moth does storytelling. So there are these resources beyond what's discarded. And in a way they're discarded because we're just not using them to their full value. And I do think that organizations, systems can access things that are at hand to enhance their purpose, their outcome, and engage a wider audience in their mission. Mm-hmm.
That's super interesting. It's a greatly great point, which brings me back to another question actually for Sabrina about, you know, resources that are out there that are underutilized. And, you know, you're focusing on supporting women and non-binary artisans from Latin America, Sabrina, and, you know, you're bolstering their value. And so I wonder, could you talk a little bit about that and why that's important to you?
Well, again, that is related with my origin. I mean, I was born in Argentina. It's a country which is very machist, and we have a lot of, we called femicidios, which means that there's a lot of people that are abused and even murdered for their families and husbands. And there is a lot of violence against women. And it's also very difficult to get into different jobs. So for the same capability between a man and a woman in Argentina, at least, and I think in a lot of other places in the world, it's the same. People just choose a man without any reason, right? So, and I think that is changing a lot. But when I arrived here, as a Latin American person, I felt that. I really felt that. And I had people that support me and support my work and trusted in me. So if I had the chance to do the same with another people and to build a team with that goal, for me, it'll be very important, because I think it's a chain, right? The world is not going to change because I will have collaborating with just a few women artists or craft, but it's a way to start. And as Tommy says, is we start with some place that can make a change. So for Lufarda, that's the plan that I have. To create a team in which women can be supported by women. that's the thing, that's the goal.
Well, I'm already a fan. it's a great goal. And you know, I think all of you are making people's lives better through, you know, it's almost like furniture is the vehicle by which we can make lives better. And at the same time, hopefully put some valuable and beautiful objects out there. I want to just sorry, Mona.
I wanted to speak to some of the things that have come up, because we're talking about inequitable systems and the criminal justice system. These are all systems that have been designed in inequitable ways, and because we're at NYC by Design. This is part of NYC by Design. I think it's interesting to think about the design flaws in our lives. Waste is a design flaw, as are unhealthy and inequitable systems. And there's research, for example, by the Ellen MacArthur Foundation, which is a leader in circular economy. And they cite that the decisions we make when designing a product or a system or a service will determine 80% of their environmental impact. So we can design with environment at the forefront, but we can also design with inclusion at the forefront and equity at the forefront. And you know, one of the things when I think of design, I'm really inspired by disability rights activists who talk about how disability is designed. And this idea blew my mind when I first heard it. A wheelchair, a car, and a plane are all designed to compensate for the limitations of the human body. And so why do we label all those who are in a wheelchair as disabled? So if we can design for our inability to reach the moon, we can design with inclusion equally at the forefront. And when I think about sustainability, I also think about how we in the US have designed the social construct of race. And we are currently in this year having a reckoning with that. And you know, there was an article in the New York Times recently, which will come as no surprise, that people of color in America live with more pollution than their white neighbors, and that climate change has a disproportionate impact on communities of color. So again, we can design with equity equally at the forefront. And so as we're thinking about how we recover from this really difficult year, we need to rethink and redesign all these systems, the products, the way we buy, the way we produce, with equity and inclusion and health and environment, all of these things at the forefront equally for a livable future. And I love that we're bringing all of this together and thinking about designing for the future.
Beautifully put. That's so thought-provoking, the way that you just titled that together. And I think it is inspiring too, about how we can imagine this new future, that as we reemerge, that we don't just go back to where the way that we did things before. I think it's just so important, because so much has been exposed over this last year about where those vulnerabilities are. And to your point, like we can change that just through our decision-making, which is pretty amazing.
If I can, I would just say that Mona used in our conversation preparing for this panel, Mona used a phrase that last year was a year of reckoning for the country in a lot of ways. And I love that phrase. And I think that year of reckoning leads to a year of reckoning ahead of us, because if we don't make the changes that we all see are necessary now, that this previous year has brought to the fore in such stark ways, if we don't do that effectively, we risk what often happens is in this country, which is the pendulum swinging back the other way and mowing people down in its path. And it's really important that organizations, governments, individuals, communities, right now more than ever, I think, are purposeful in moving things like sustainability through in a whole assortment of ways to keep that momentum going and flowing forward, so that if that current becomes too strong for any of us to, or anyone to kind of swim against it.
That's great. You know, I just saw the time, and I would love to have just a moment to answer some of these questions in the chat, and encourage others to put questions in the chat, in the Q&A, please. One is from Joseph Horn. It's a question for Sabrina, actually, which is, how does or does your bicultural and binational identity and experience shape your furniture work, your reclaimed furniture work?
Well, I think, you just had to take a look into the pieces, right? I'm a bit a kind of a mix of all that things, you know? And that's the same thing that happened in my work, right? So I try to put all these things together and to keep it alive, you know, and to make it work. So that's the way. And yeah, I don't know if that answered the question, but yeah, that's the way. I try to find the common points between all the difference. And I think that's important for to create work and to live too, to create better places to work, better places to collaborate, better places for everything. Yeah.
It's we could use that as an analogy, really, that to find the common points between all the conditions. That's a nice way to put it.
How you can make it work, you know? What all these things have in common and you can make it work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great. Here's another question. Maybe it's a comment and a question from Joseph Schneider, which is, it would be so great if post-pandemic recovery goes so much further than to rebuilding it before. So I think this is in response, Mona, to something that you've said, which is, so are there specific visions for a hugely more sustainable new reality? And that's a great question. Because it's true, it feels like we need a paradigm shift. It's not time for small shifts. This is time for paradigm shift. And it's absolutely true. I mean, if we look at all the statistics again, if we go back to that, it's, you know, there's these goals for 2030 so that we can mitigate a little bit of climate change so that we, you know, we don't go downhill quite so fast. There's other statistics about toxics in the environment that are sending sperm counts so low that we may not even have a human population past 2050. So, you know, there are these big, you know, data that's coming from scientists. And at the same time, what we're talking about here is we desperately need more equity for the human species. So, yeah, I don't know, anybody could respond to that, Mona, Sabrina, or Tommy.
I just wanna echo something Mona said previously, which was, you know, waste is a design flaw. And looking at design of, particularly of systems, and I just use the criminal justice system as an example. You know, I've asked legislators, law enforcement, DAs, superintendents and wardens of prisons and heads of post-incarceration organizations, what's the purpose of our criminal justice system? And they all have very eloquent answers. The problem is no two are the same. So everybody is kind of working towards different ends and there's not a common purpose or goal. And that creates a lot of waste and also creates a lot of unintended consequences and a very bad use of resources, both human and financial. So looking, and it's, you know, it takes leadership and it takes pressure on leadership, but in this year going forward, as the person asked, like really look, being more self reflective as both as individuals and as businesses and organizations and as a society to try and create design systems that are more elegant, more purposeful, and that meet our values and that get a return on the resources that we put into them.
Mona, did you have a response to that also?
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking about what Tommy was saying, but what I was thinking before was also related to what Sabrina was saying about affordability and disposability, and how we in different cultures, we don't throw out the way we do, especially in the US. I think of the example of IKEA. Their premise was that they were creating with democratic design. It was about designing for equity, this and the concept of democratic design. But what we have taken from that because of, you know, our culture of consumption is that anything that is affordable is disposable. We don't think about it as a democratic We don't use a democratic lens, an accessible lens. We just throw things out. Like, it's like Sabrina was saying, it's much cheaper to throw out a couch than to move it to your new apartment and pay for the movers to do that. So it's really, I've been really interested in thinking about how we shift culture on consumption. So that we're just not throwing out over 12 million, you know, tons of furniture each year.
I mean, yeah. So much of this is really, it's so much about behavioral change. That we have to become, well, Tommy says, like, we have to become more self-reflective. Like, scaled change starts with each individual, unfortunately, in a way, because we have billions of people to change, you know, these, you know, perspectives, I was going to say, but actually it's actions, you know, how we consume and where we dispose and where we don't. And it's just so interesting also to think about how some cultures already have this predisposition or a culture of reuse, a culture of, you know.
But you know what? It's again about the affordable thing. You know, if you can, is the thing that Mona was saying. You choose it because it's cheaper than do another thing, and we had to recognize even with art, right, that there are something about the way in which you produce, how much you produce, that is related with the price of the objects, right? So I think that's the thing that has to change, because we reuse a lot of stuff because it's cheaper in our country than buy a new one, you know. So if you are going to think to throw out a television before you go to a people that it will fix it, that is almost crazy to think here. Nobody is going to think about fix it. And the same with the furniture. Unless you have a collective, a piece that is for a collectionist, you know what I mean?
That's so interesting, because I mean, then I think, Tommy, you have a new aspect of your refoundry business. We need to teach people how to fix things. Because I think, you know, if my television broke, I wouldn't know where to bring it. Those people don't exist in Brooklyn anymore. Or yeah. there are a few. I shouldn't say that. There are some. But, you know, we need to do that. We need to teach people more about how to fix things, I think. This has just been so fascinating. And I just looked at the time and realized that we promised to complete by 11:15, and here we are right there at that moment. Any last comments that are very short before we close? Mona, did you have something you were going to say?
Speaking to the last points, there's a new legislation on the table in New York State for extended producer responsibility. That can help us create systems for post-consumer use, and that the companies are responsible for helping to pay for that. So maybe there'll be more refurbishing and recycling and reselling in buybacks and buyback programs and such in the future. I'm hoping for that.
That's great. That's great. I hope that really comes to pass. So thank you all for coming. It's been a really interesting conversation. Sabrina and Tommy and Mona, I've just had a great time talking with you, and I feel like nourished in a way for new ways to think about reemerging, and for, you know, from our audience to provoke us to think about big, big change, and, you know, not just small changes, but it sounds like in your work, you're all doing that. So, you know, kudos to you. Thank you so much for spending time and dedication towards this conversation today. It's been really nourishing and fulfilling. And thank you again to NYC by Design for hosting this conversation. So important for design, really, this idea of human equity equality, as well as design. And thank you to mebl for collaborating with us, for bringing us into this conversation. It's been delightful. I'll speak from Parsons Healthy Materials Lab on that.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Sabrina and Tommy. This was really great to be together and talk about these important issues together, and to see some beautiful furniture, features, Sabrina and Tommy.
Thank you.
Anya, did you want to flash that last slide so you can find where we all are? Yeah, just here's a little bit about each of the organizations that we talked about today, where you can find us on the World Wide Web, where you can find us on social media. We look forward to being in touch with you. Thanks again for coming.